That is, that we are living in this world with an eye that is looking beyond this world and looking ahead, and what it sees ahead is motivating us to live with hope. Hope is one of the most important psychological qualities in our lives. And hopelessness is one of the most destructive and despairing qualities in our lives.
Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. For my part in this I see nothing but the blood of Jesus. For my cleansing, this my plea, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Nothing but the blood. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Nothing but the blood.
In the book of Romans, Paul reveals the relationship between human and godly righteousness. While it's important to understand the teachings inside the pages of Romans, it's life-saving to put them into practice. Today's message is called Living in Hope.
Well, good morning. Now let me read you from Romans chapter 8, and we've been looking into Romans for many weeks, and I want to read a few verses from verse 17 down to verse 25. And I want to talk about a vitally important issue this morning that we don't talk very much about, but something which is vital for all of us here, and it is this whole sense of living with hope. That's the key word, hope. We don't talk a lot about hope, but Paul does in these verses. Let me read from verse 17 to get the context. Verse 17 says, "Now if we are children, then we are heirs, heirs of God and co-heirs with Christ, if indeed we share in his suffering, in order that we may share in his glory. I consider that our present sufferings are not worth comparing with the glory that will be revealed in us. The creation waits in eager expectation for the sons of God to be revealed, for the creation was subjected to frustration, not by its own choice, but by the will of the one who subjected it, in the hope that the creation itself will be liberated from its bondage to decay and brought into the glorious freedom of the children of God. We know that the whole creation has been groaning as in the pains of childbirth right up to the present time. Not only so, but we ourselves who have the first fruits of the Spirit groan inwardly as we wait eagerly for our adoption as sons, the redemption of our bodies. And here's my key verse this morning. For in this hope we are saved. But hope that is seen is no hope at all. Who hopes for what he already has? But if we hope what we do not yet have, we wait for it patiently. That's as far as I am reading. And that last verse, that little word hope, occurs five times. Hope comes across to us as rather a weak word. I gave the title to this message, Living in Hope. And that sounds lacking in confidence. You know, when we're almost given up, we say, well, we can always live in hope, which means we really are not very certain and sure. If I were to ask you the question, does your wife love you? And you answered, I hope so. I may not be too sure that you have a good marriage. If I say, are you healthy today? And you say, I hope so. I might conclude you're a hypochondriac. If I asked you, are you a Christian? And you answered, I hope so. Then I might think you are in need of some assurance. It doesn't sound too confident. The word hope contains for many of us uncertainty, ambiguity. It is tentative. It is vague. And yet this word hope is given a very high status in the scriptures. In 1 Corinthians 13 and verse 13, Paul speaks of the three great virtues of the Christian life. He says, these three remain, faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these is love, and we will agree with that. We recognize and understand why love is a great virtue. We understand that faith is a necessary virtue, especially when you've been reading through the book of Romans. Faith is indispensable, because we're justified by faith and saved by faith and cleansed by faith and lived by faith. It's an indispensable quality in the Christian life. But hope doesn't quite seem to be in the same league. It doesn't have the same force, the same importance. Now, the hope that Paul refers to in this passage is not the hope of wishful thinking. It is the hope of confident expectation that there are things not yet experienced, not yet part of my life, for which I have absolute ground to anticipate that these are going to be part of my life. Now, if you read these verses carefully, you'll see that Paul writes about hope in a context of writing about suffering and decay. In verse 18, he talks about our present sufferings. Verse 20, he says, for the creation was subject to frustration. Verse 21, he amplifies that. The creation itself will be liberated from its bondage to decay. Verse 22, we know that the whole creation has been groaning as in the pains of childbirth right up to the present time. So he uses these words to describe life that we are part of, the natural life all around us. He uses the words suffering, the word frustration, the word bondage, the word decay, the word pain. And he's saying, as you look around, everything is decaying, everything is disintegrating, and everything is dying. If you're not sure about that, or you need some convincing, just once in a while look carefully into the mirror, and you're not what you used to be. Change and decay, and all around I see, is the line of a hymn. But not only is it in creation, Paul talks big picture about creation, groaning, and in travail, and subjected to frustration. But in verse 23, he says, not only so, but we ourselves who have the first fruits of the Spirit. That is, we are indwelt by the Holy Spirit. We ourselves are the first fruits of the Spirit, groan inwardly as we wait eagerly for our adoption as sons, the redemption of our body. There is universal suffering that he talks about on the big canvas, but there is personal suffering he writes about in the individual experience of every one of us. But parallel to that in these verses is suffering on the one hand and hope on the other. Coming to terms with suffering is not easy for any of us. We can theorize till the cows come home about suffering, and then you get diagnosed with cancer, or then you start to go blind, or then you find yourself in a road accident and you are permanently damaged, or whatever else may be part and parcel of our lives. And suddenly all our philosophical theories about suffering don't mean a lot. Within Christendom, there are attempts to address and answer the question of suffering. It ranges on one end of the spectrum with the idea that all suffering is unnecessary to a believer, and that by an act of faith, it can be removed, it can be eliminated. And many of us will not have a theology of that, though some do, but I would suggest most of us have a prayer life that believes that. What do we pray for people who are suffering? Lord, take it away. Lord, heal it. Lord, remove it. Lord, get them out of it. The other end of the spectrum says that everything that happens in our lives is in accordance with the sovereign will of God. And so suffering and all that goes with it is subject to his will. And so that's what God has sent into your life. And you try to see some good reason for it. In between those two spectrum, there are other various ideas. For instance, that suffering is a chastisement. We don't normally apply that to other people and say, oh, they're being judged and chastised. But we so often apply that to ourselves. Why has this happened to me? Am I being chastised? Am I being punished? Is this the judgment of God? And you know that because often when things go wrong, first question we ask is, what have I done? And so we have a tit-for-tat kind of thinking in our minds that I'm experiencing this because of that. Remember Job, when he suffered in the Old Testament, he had three friends who came along, and his three friends basically adopted this perspective. They said, Job, there must be a reason. What did you do? You must have done something wrong. There must be some secret sin in your life. And Job said, I can't think of anything. And they said, you need to think harder, Job, because that's another one. That's a lie. There's something inside your life. That's the reason why you've gone through all this suffering. And so you can be sure that if there's some global event like a hurricane that causes awful disasters or floods or the outbreak of HIV/AIDS 20 years ago or the 9/11 event in 2001 or some tsunami, there'll be those Christians will pop up and say, this is the judgment of God, and they will attribute this to whatever the sins of the nation are that they feel have brought this about. Now, all these views may contain elements of truth within them. But what if suffering is simply a fact of life in our fallen world? And it's a fact of life to the extent that suffering is indiscriminate. It doesn't single some people out for suffering and single some people out for exemption, but it is indiscriminate without specific cause. Jesus said, God causes his sun to rise on the evil and the good, and sends rain on the righteous and the unrighteous. He's saying there that the weather patterns show no discrimination against the unrighteous, nor do they favor the righteous. So famines, earthquakes, floods, tsunamis, accidents affect believers and non-believers alike, as do germs, as do viruses, as does disease and fevers and degeneration and heart attacks and cancer cells. One group of people is not exempt from these things by virtue of their spiritual lives, for instance. The rain comes on the just and the unjust in the same way. In fact, what he's saying here is that there's something that is fundamentally broken in the world in which we're a part, of which suffering is part of that brokenness. The whole creation is in pain. It's groaning like a mother in childbirth, which means, by the way, something better is coming. But the process, right up to this present time, he says. And Christians not exempt from this, for the next verse 23 says, not only so, we ourselves, who are the first fruits of the Spirit, groan inwardly as we wait eagerly for our adoption as sons, the redemption of our bodies. So creation groans, the Christian groans. There's a lot of groaning going on in Romans 8. Not moaning, that's different. Groaning, in pain. And it's in this that Paul speaks about hope. Verse 20, for the creation was subjected to frustration, not by its own choice, but by the will of the one who subjected it, in hope that the creation itself will be liberated from its bondage. So the hope there relates to something yet to come that will liberate the creation from its bondage and decay and brought into the glorious freedom of the children of God. So there's a hope for something that's going to come that's going to liberate us from this bondage and this decay. And verse 24, verse 25, for in this hope we are saved. The significance and meaning of that is really, in this hope we are safe. But hope that is seen is no hope at all. Who hopes what they already have? But if we hope what we do not yet have, we wait for it patiently. That is, that we are living in this world with an eye that is looking beyond this world and looking ahead, and what it sees ahead is motivating us to live with hope. Hope is one of the most important psychological qualities in our lives. And hopelessness is one of the most destructive and despairing qualities in our lives. Hope is oriented to the future, something to come, something else, something outside of what I'm in now that's bigger and better. I appreciate very much the writings of Viktor Frankl, whose name some of you will know, though he's been dead about 15 years now. Viktor Frankl was an Austrian Jew. And in the 1930s, he trained in medicine in Vienna, specializing in psychiatry, which is a new discipline back in at that time. And his first job was to work in a medical practice where he had to work with suicide patients, that is, those who'd attempted suicide. And he would talk with them and find out about their woes and their despair and what was leading them to suicide. And he said he observed that they all, or most of them certainly, talked about events in their past that have left them in this place of despair. They might have been attacked, might have been raped, might have been abused in some way, might have lost everything that they had. They've had a broken marriage. But Frankl, in thinking about this, realized he knew people who had worse pasts than some of these people, who are not suicidal at all. And he came to the conclusion that their problem was not their past. Their problem was their future. Or more precisely, their lack of a sense of future. In fact, he concluded and he wrote, and I quote, "A person can live with any past if they have a sense of future." The 1930s, 37 was, or 38, 37, I think it was, Hitler annexed Austria, and it became dangerous for Jews, and he had opportunity to leave Austria and go and study in a safe environment, but he decided he should remain in Vienna, and subsequently he was arrested and placed in a Nazi concentration camp, along with his wife, 23 years of age, who he had just married a couple of months before, his father, his mother, his brother, and they were taken to Auschwitz, the most notorious of all the camps, and he was divided from his wife and his parents and his brother at the camp when they were taken different directions. His wife was taken straight to the gas chamber and was killed straight away. His parents all died there. He didn't know this till after the war. And Frankl lost everything he possessed. He suffered hunger, cold. They had to work with completely inadequate clothing in freezing weather, experienced brutality of some of the sadistic guards who looked after them, and every hour expecting their time for extermination would come. He survived all of that, and his best-known book is a book called Man's Search for Meaning. He's written a number of books. Man's Search for Meaning tells the story of his experience in the concentration camps in Auschwitz, and then he was taken to Dachau, another notorious camp. Many were put to death in the ovens when they became weak and inadequate, or even when they got sick. But many of those who weren't put to death in the gas ovens died naturally. They'd wake up in the morning, and there'd always be one or two dead there. And others survived, and including Frankl himself, survived right to the end of the war when they were liberated, when the Russians came in to that area. He noticed that a common ingredient in those who lived was hope. They talked about the future. He said sometimes they would sit and discuss what they would do when the war was over, even though they had no knowledge of anything. They had no news, and most of them knew they were likely to die. Frankl put his own chance of survival at 1 to 20. He was 19 times more likely to be killed than he was to survive. And he worked it out on the basis of a number of factors that he observed and considered. And most of them were in that kind of situation. But they would talk about what they would do, talk about what kind of home they would live in, how much space they would have, what kind of beds they would buy, living as they were now on these hard wooden slats, crammed in together with hundreds of other men. They talked about how they would spend their freedom. They talked about being reunited with their wives, meeting again their children, meeting again their parents who'd be waiting for them. They talk about inviting each other around for meals, and they'd say, "This is what I'm going to cook you." And meanwhile, they were starving. Their bodies were skeletal. They would eat just one bowl of soup that was watery. They were lucky, two or three peas in it, and half a piece of bread was their ration every day. And he said, this spirit of hope that we generated amongst each other, some of us, kept him alive. He said there was a man came to him one day who had been a famous musician, and he told him that he had a dream. And in this dream, someone had said to me, ask me for anything you want. And I asked to know when I'd be released from this prison. And Frankl said, did you get an answer? Yes, I did. March the 30th, 1945. This dream had taken place in February 1945. When he told Frankl this, he said he was full of hope. His eyes twinkled. Not many eyes twinkled in the concentration camp. He said this man had new energy, new optimism. He had a different demeanor. And he told people, March the 30th, I've been told in a dream, I'm going to be free. And Frankl says, as the month of March progressed and we got towards the end of the month, it became very evident nobody was going to be free by March the 30th. March the 29th, he said, this man became ill. March the 30th, he became delirious and he lost consciousness. And on March the 31st, he died. He said, to all appearances, he died of typhus. But Frankl says he didn't. He died of no hope. I quote, his faith in the future and his will to live had become paralyzed, and his body fell victim to illness. He said, you know, that the death rate in those camps rose at Christmas and New Year because people in their minds would say, I'm going to be out by Christmas, I'm going to be out by the New Year. And they weren't, and the death rate would rise in those last weeks of the year. After the war, Frankl developed a branch of psychiatry known as logotherapy, logo from the Greek word logos, which in our Bible translates as word. He translated as meaning therapy. And the theme is to survive any hardship. Our life needs to be oriented to something bigger and better that's outside of ourselves. Frankl believed that a key to people's peace of mind lay in what they hoped for. Psychologists spend hours unwrapping people's past, but in the reality, Frankl says, it is their future that needs to be unwrapped. And from that position, you can then address all the pains. You have the courage to address all the pains and the issues of the past. And this is a theme that Paul writes about here. He sets our difficult past and present, our suffering, the decay, the groaning, the pain. He uses all those words of this world. He sets that against something to which we can aspire and for which we can have hope. So he compares our present sufferings with future glory in verse 17. Now, if we are children, then we're heirs, heirs of God and co-heirs with Christ. If indeed we share in his sufferings, that's part of our life, in order that we may share in his glory. And he says there is this suffering we are to share in, but that suffering, he compares, will lead to glory, and the greatness of our suffering will lead to the greatness experience of his glory. And he's looking future there to that which is glorious. And in verse 18, he contrasts them as well. I consider that our present sufferings are not worth comparing with the glory that will be revealed in us. So he compares and he contrasts. He compares suffering in this life will bear resemblance to the glory on the other side of the spectrum. I remember telling you this because it impressed me very much some time ago, but I remember once going to hear a well-known speaker in England, a preacher, and I went with a friend, and we went to hear this man, and when it was over, we were talking about it, and I said to my friend, what do you think of his message? He said, well, it was a really good message, but he said, I think life's too easy for him. If he were to suffer, I think it would have been a great message. I was a bit taken aback. I thought, wow, that's an interesting perspective. But this man did actually suffer. His wife went into a very deep depression. She had to be hospitalized. She attempted suicide twice. And this man had to go through the dark, dark valley of that. And then his wife did die prematurely. She didn't commit suicide, but she did die. And the last years of her life were awfully dark years for her. And I heard this man preach again. And he had a depth he never had before. Suffering does bring about a deepening of our lives often, if we respond to it with humility. But the contrast, that's the comparison, but the contrast is that our present sufferings in verse 18 are not worth comparing with the glory that will be revealed in us. You know, elsewhere, 2 Corinthians 4, verse 17, Paul says, "For our light and momentary troubles are achieving for us an eternal glory that far outweighs them all. So we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but on what is unseen. What is seen is temporary, what is unseen is eternal." That's 2 Corinthians 4, verse 17. And Paul is saying, there are elements of the Christian life you must understand are bigger and better and deeper and greater than you will know in this life, but what you will know in that future life. The eternal glory outweighs these momentary troubles. What is seen is temporary, what is unseen is eternal. There are the seen and the unseen elements of our Christian experience. There is the present and the future elements of our Christian experience. There is the now and the not yet elements of our Christian experience. And I am indebted to John Stott. I heard him give a message some years ago, which he talked about the now and the not yet of the Christian experience and the importance of not confusing these two, of enjoying the now and being patient about the not yet and not trying to bring the not yet into the now, was really what he was talking about. And I am going to give you five areas where Scripture contrasts the now, what we have now, can enjoy now, experience now, and the not yet, which is still to come, where the now, the down payment, will be enjoyed in full. And the five areas are, first of all, intellectually, that is in the realm of knowledge. Now, Scripture tells us, God has revealed himself in creation, in our conscience, in Scripture, in the person of Jesus Christ, who is the supreme revelation of God. To the extent, in Romans 1:20, Paul says that what may be known about God is known to men so that men are without excuse. And if you read Psalm 19 as well, you'll see the heavens declare the glory of God, etc. And you read to that psalm, and it talks about creation and Scripture and conscience revealing God to us. But the not yet intellectually in this realm of knowledge is, for instance, 1 Corinthians 13, verse 9, "For now we know in part." We know in part. We don't know everything. 1 John 3, verse 2, "What we will be has not yet been made known." There are things we do not know. Deuteronomy 29, 29 says, "The secret things belong to the Lord our God, but the things revealed belong to us and to our children." So the things that are revealed that we know, the things God has not revealed we don't know, and we must be patient with the fact there are things we do not know. Sometimes I fear that as Christians we feel we have to have an explanation for everything, and we don't. And a mark of maturity is to recognizing we do not know many things as well as knowing we do know the things that God has revealed to us. If I quote John Stott, he said, "We need more confidence about what has been revealed and more humility about what is not revealed." So there are things we know and there are things we do not know. Secondly, morally, that is in the area of behavior, in the realm of how we behave ourselves and live, Now in the present, Romans 5 verse 1, you have been justified. That is, you stand before God, the justice of God satisfied in the person of Jesus, and we have been justified as a result. Romans 8 verse 9, the Spirit of God lives in you. That's now. 1 Corinthians 6 verse 11, you were sanctified. That is, something's already taken place, he speaks of. And then there are many other passages. It speaks of the fruit of the Spirit being available to us here and now. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. We are being changed from one degree of glory to another, 2 Corinthians chapter 3. There are many, many other verses we could include here. But there is a not yet about these things too. Philippians 3 verse 12, Paul says, not that I have already obtained all this or have already been made perfect, but I press on to take hold of that for which Christ Jesus took hold of me. I have not obtained these things. I'm pressing on. I'm moving on. And in 1 John 3 and verse 2, but we know that when he appears, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. But we're not like him yet, not in fullness, not in entirety. We do not yet love God with all our hearts and soul and strength and love our neighbor as ourself. We're not yet perfect, as Jesus said, be perfect, even your Heavenly Father is perfect. But these things are to come, those are the not yet. Thirdly, and we'll just go quickly through these. We could spend time talking about each one of them, but I just want to make the point. There's a not yet aspect to our lives too. Socially, in the realm of society, there are things that are now. You are, said Jesus, Matthew 5, 16, the salt of the earth. You are the light of the world. Your presence is making a difference in our world. But there is the not yet that Scripture tells us is coming. For instance, Micah 4 and verse 3, they will beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. Nation will not take up sword against nation, nor will they train for war anymore. And this text, by the way, is on the entrance hall of the United Nations in New York. If you go to that building, you go inside, you see this text on the wall. But it's a pipe dream as far as the UN is concerned. But it's a reality one day, but not yet. Not yet in this fallen world we live in now. Revelation 11 and verse 15 says, the kingdom of the world has become the kingdom of our Lord and of his Christ. That is not yet true. You look at the news, you see what's happening in different parts of the world, and you do not say, this kingdom of the world has become the kingdom of Jesus Christ, but one day it will. There's a not yet aspect to the social, societal aspects of how our world is going to run and function physically in the realm of physical well-being. Romans 8, 23 says, in the present, we ourselves who have the first fruits of the Spirit groan inwardly as we wait eagerly for adoption as sons, the redemption of our bodies, that we experience this groaning, the pains of this life. Hebrews 2 verse 14, speaking of the Lord Jesus, he too shared in our humanity, that by his death he might destroy him who holds the power of death. The point is, by sharing in our humanity, he shared in death, because that is part of this experience of humanity. But the not yet that is to come. Revelation 21 verse 4, there will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain. There's going to come a day like that. 1 Corinthians 15 verse 54, when the perishable has been clothed with the imperishable and the mortal with immortality, then the saying that is written will come true. Death has been swallowed up in victory. That day is going to come. But in the meantime, we continue to decay. We continue to age. We continue to die. Our bodies have not yet been redeemed, but one day they will be. One day your body will be in good nick. Very good nick. But that's to come. And then corporately in the realm of the church, where corporately we are together, now in the present, 1 Corinthians 12, 13, we were all baptized by one Spirit into one body. That is, we're united now in Christ. That's in the present. 1 Timothy 3, verse 15, Paul speaks of the church of the living God, the pillar and foundation of the truth. We are part of that. We enjoy those elements. but the not yet that is still to come. Revelation 19, verse 7, for the wedding of the Lamb has come and his bride has made herself ready. We see it's all about a romance and the church is going to be the bride of Christ. And Revelation 21, verse 2 speaks of being prepared as a bride, beautifully dressed for her husband. This is the new Jerusalem that we're going to be part of, that is going to come down and be married to Jesus Christ in the picture it gives us here. We do not have a perfect church yet. We will not have a perfect church yet here on this earth. If you come to this church looking for a perfect church, your coming here, it will itself spoil it, because you're not perfect. But one day, there's going to be that perfection. And we need to be confident about what is now, but patient about what is not yet, but live with the not yet as a confident expectation. And John Stott says, in relation to this, there are three kinds of Christians. He says, there's the optimist wants everything now. They rejoice in all they have in Christ, but they look for no sin. They look for no disease. They look for freedom from all of these things now, and that is not what we have been offered. That's the optimist. And there's the pessimist. The pessimist is into the not yet. So they simply grin and bear and expect nothing now except, well, one day I'm going to get out of this. I'm going to arrive in heaven. And they're looking for the sweet by and by, and they're not enjoying what is available in the present. So you've got the optimist, you've got the pessimist, you've got the realist who lives in the tension between the now and the not yet. The realist who says, this is what I have now, this is what I enjoy now, this is what is part of my experience now, but it is not complete in this life. I do suffer, I do fail, I do battle, but one day we will move beyond this. And so we live by faith. During the present, which you must, we trust in God, and we live with hope regarding the future, which also we must. Let me just take you back to Viktor Frankl before I finish. When a patient came into Viktor Frankl's office, his surgery, to talk to him about their torments, whether they were great or small, and what seems small to somebody may be great to somebody else, of course, he would often listen to their tale of woe and their despair. And sometimes he would ask them this question. He'd say, why don't you commit suicide? Which is a rather disarming question to come from your doctor. Why don't you commit suicide? And Frankl says that the answer they gave him was often the key to that person's well-being. Why don't you commit suicide? Well, because I have my children. I love my children. And Frank would say, that's a key. That's a key, one key to the meaning of your days ahead, your future. Or somebody might say, you know, I want to accomplish things that I haven't accomplished. I want to use a gift or a talent in a certain way. Or I want to preserve memories, and I don't want to lose those memories. The object of our hope was never permanent, Frankl points out, and I read one of his books on the way home yesterday in preparation for this, if it was a material thing. So in prison, somebody would say, I hope to get my land back when I'm out of prison. My land was confiscated, maybe a farmer or something, or a businessman of some kind. I want to get my land back when I finish. And that would be okay. That would give them hope, something to look for. But it always has to become personal. When I get my land back, I will also have my wife back, my family back. And you know, in Scripture, it is not just we're going somewhere where the streets are paved with gold. Wonderful. as that future is. But in Psalm 33, verse 18, the psalmist writes this, "But the eyes of the Lord are on those who fear him, on those whose hope is in his unfailing love, to deliver them from death and to keep them alive in famine. We wait in hope for the Lord. He is our help and our shield. In him our hearts rejoice, or we trust in his holy name." That's Psalm 33, verse 18 to 21. So the psalmist is saying there that my hope is in God himself and in his unfailing love, in the fact that he is my shield. Yes, we're going to have a body that is going to be perfected one day, our resurrection bodies. We're going to live forever with no death, no tears, no sadness. That is that promise in Revelation. But, you know, it's not just a case of it's better geography. Well, we move out of this life and go to a better location. It's better real estate than it is here. It's streets of gold. That's better than tarmac. Yeah. No. You get as bored in heaven as you're bored on earth. It's just about real estate. Our hope is in God himself. Our hope is in his love. Our hope is in the fact that I love God and I'm loved by God. Frankl one day was walking freezing cold, 5 o'clock in the morning, with a man who had great blisters on his feet, and they had just shoddy clothing. It was frozen outside. This man was leaning on him, and they were dressed in ragged clothes. And this man said to Frankl, "Just imagine if our wives could see us now." And Frankl said, "My mind went to my wife, and all that day, I thought about her. I'd blocked her out." He didn't know she was dead then. He didn't know if she was alive or dead. She was dead. He didn't know that. It was her 24th birthday, the next day, actually. And he says, I thought about her. I thought about everything I loved about her. I looked at her face in my eyes. I looked at her eyes. I listened to her voice. I could hear her voice. I began to talk to her. And I really felt she was talking back to me. He said, I entered into this in the middle of the hardship he was in. I entered into this time of just enjoying being with my wife. And he said, and I learned that day that the greatest factor in anybody's life is love. The temperature wasn't as cold. My stomach was not quite as hungry. My despair was not quite as deep. I knew I loved my wife. He writes like that, even though she was dead, which he didn't know. But you know, we have a God who's alive, and he loves us. My hope, says the psalmist, is in his unfailing love. We wait in hope for the Lord. He is our help. He is our shield. He is our protector, in other words. Let me ask as I finish. Do you face every day with hope? It looks outside of today, looks out of now, looks outside of the transient, looks outside of the temporary, looks to the eternal, looks to God himself. Romans 15, 13 finishes with this. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Spirit. It is this hope which brings joy, he says, and peace. If you don't know Christ, you don't know God, you don't have a relationship with him, you won't know this hope. He will be the hope which will enable you every day to live with whatever circumstance has been thrown at you, trusting him and at peace. Let's pray together. Lord Jesus Christ, we thank you this morning that we're not alone in this dark, dangerous, painful, suffering world. existentially on our own. But thank you so much. We can live in relationship with yourself, where we know God and we trust you and we hope in you and we hope in your agenda, because we hope in your person, the God of unfailing love towards us, the God of peace, the God of joy, as Paul wrote there, in whom we put our hope, but a God too who has the future timetable firmly in place that we're going to share with you forever. Help us, we pray, men and women who live in hope. Pray it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Do you know someone who would benefit from this message? Share it through our website, livingtruth.ca. And while you're online, join the discussion about this week's message and follow the links to our Facebook page and YouTube channel. Tune in next week for the continuation in this series from Charles Price. In the book of Romans, Paul reveals the relationship between human and godly righteousness. This union between biblical principles and everyday life illustrates the importance of both what we believe and how we live out those beliefs. Does your daily life truly reflect your biblical beliefs, or do you find yourself in a constant battle of double standards? This series by Charles Price is available on CD and DVD. Learn at home, give to a friend, or plan a group Bible study. To order this series, write to the address on your screen or call +1 416 222 3341, extension 113. To order online, visit livingtruth.ca. While it's important to understand the pages of Romans, it's life-saving to put them into practice.
What a friend we have in Jesus. All our sins and griefs to bear. God in prayer. Oh, what peace we often forfeit. Oh, what needless pain we bear. All because we do not carry everything to God in prayer. take it to the Lord in prayer. Do thy friends despise, forsake thee. Take it to the Lord in prayer. In his arms he'll take and shield thee. You will find a solace there. Take it to the Lord. We will take.